Welcome back. This is lecture three of chapter one. And here we want to take a look at the evolution of Earth. Initially, as the Earth formed, it was quite hot. As things began to cool, the iron and nickel sank to the center of our Earth, forming our core. Lighter, more buoyant material rose to produce a very primitive crust that did not last very long due to the harsh nature of the planet at that time. And so this chemical differentiation is what we call the layering of our Earth into three different layers. We have our core, mantle, and crust. And I think most of us are familiar with those terms from elementary school. In addition to the Earth differentiating into those three compositional layers, we call them, a primitive atmosphere also evolved because of an extreme amount of volcanic activity that was releasing gases from the Earth's interior. So let's take a look at the crust first as one of our compositional layers. It's thin, it's rocky, and we have two main types of crust. We have crust that makes up the continent, so we'll call it continental crust, and we have oceanic crust. Some of the differences between the oceanic versus continental crust include their thicknesses. Ocean crust is thin compared to continents. Also, the composition of ocean crust is a basalt, which is an igneous rock, and the composition of continental crust approximates a granodiorite. The mantle exists below the crust, approximately 2,900 kilometers in thickness, and is made up of a rock called a peridotite that we'll talk more about in our igneous rock chapter. And then we discussed the core previously. That's where iron and nickel sits. Now we can also divide our planet into what are called physical layers. And instead of the chemistry of these layers varying, what varies is their physical properties. So let's start with our lithosphere. That is the rigid outer part of the Earth, consisting of the crust and uppermost mantle. The asthenosphere sits below the lithosphere and is a much softer, and it's considered a weak layer compared to the lithosphere. We go into what's called the transition zone, where the density of the rock increases significantly from the asthenosphere. So that would be the physical difference between the asthenosphere and transition, is the density of the rock. We have our lower mantle, which is a strong, very hot rocks that flow. And then finally, we have our outer core, that is a liquid, versus our inner core, which is a solid. So the physical properties that vary between the outer and inner core are their state. So liquid versus solid. Here's an image of our Earth, breaking it up into the physical layers versus our chemical or compositional layers. Let's talk about the three major groups of rocks we're all familiar with from elementary school as well: igneous, sedimentary, and metamorphic. And what we're going to talk about is their basic features. We will have individual chapters on each one of these rock types. The rock cycle is just a cycle that essentially says that whatever rock you are starting with, depending on what path, what journey that rock takes, it can be turned into any other type of rock. So if we take a look at this first picture up here, they're showing igneous rocks. forming when molten rock solidifies at the surface. We call that extrusive. And if it cools beneath the surface, we call it an intrusive igneous rock. And this lava flow shown here is from SP Crater in northern Arizona. The middle picture is sedimentary rocks that consist of particles that were weathered from pre-existing rocks and then subsequently transported and lithified into a sedimentary rock. This is the Navajo sandstone that we're looking at here in Utah. And then finally, our last group, the metamorphic rocks. This is the Vishnu schist. I think I mentioned that in the first lecture in chapter one. And this is the rock, what we call the basement crystalline rock at the bottom of the Grand Canyon. Summarizing, igneous rocks then form from the cooling and solidification of molten rock. Sedimentary rocks can form from the weathering of pre-existing rocks, which lithify into sedimentary rocks and accumulate in layers of the Earth's surface. Our last group of rocks are metamorphic rocks, and they form by changing pre-existing igneous, sedimentary, or other metamorphic rocks. So what drives metamorphism, the mechanisms of metamorphism are heat and pressure. So let's take a view at the rock cycle and take a starting point. We'll start with lava. So this is magma, molten material that has extruded at the Earth's surface. It can cool and crystallize and follow this purple arrow here and become an extrusive igneous rock. Then that igneous rock could be weathered, transported, and deposited as sediment. The sediment can then become lithified and turn into a sedimentary rock. That sedimentary rock could be metamorphosed then and become a metamorphic rock. So depending on what arrow you follow, what you will find is that whatever rock you start with, depending on the path, whether it be a blue arrow or the purple arrow, any rock can become any other rock depending on which arrow or path it takes.